south of the border, down Mexico way. That's where I fell in love when the stars above came up to play. And now as I wander.
Hello there, all you expat wannabes. I'm Johnny Mueller, and you're listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America, the show that tells you just what it's like to live, work, play, and or retire down here in Latin America. It's a mix of the good, the bad, the ugly, and the great, and it's all right here, so let's get started.
All right, let's start by talking about a guy named Abdallah Jaime Bucaram Ortiz. You know who he is? Probably not. Let me fill you in on this idiot. Well, he's an Ecuadorian politician and lawyer who was president of Ecuador back in the late 1990s. His nickname back then when he was president was El Loco Que Ama, means the crazy lover, or the idiot who loves. You could have it either way. You got to wonder, how do you get a name like that? Anyway, he was removed from office after being declared mentally unfit to rule by the National Congress. Talk about calling the kettle black. You'd think being mentally unfit for the job would be a prerequisite. Man, it makes you wonder how these idiots rise so high in politics. Well, you know what they say, politics is like a plugged-up toilet. All the biggest chunks float to the top. Man, have they got that right. So then, what happened to this guy? Well, he took the millions he stole from the Ecuadorian government. He moved to Panama under political asylum because other Latin countries will always accept a deposed dictator or genocidal maniac, as long as he's got a big bank account or slush fund. So he did what so many corrupt ex-presidents do. He became a fugitive living the high life in Panama. So anyway, he waited it out in the lap of luxury in Panama for around 15 years and came back to Ecuador in 2017 when the charges against him expired. You know, statute of limitations and all that. He's been living in his native country, Ecuador, for the last couple of years, spreading his dough around, playing the big shot as sociopaths are wont to do. So then, what's this got to do with anything? Well, he's in the news again today. Let me read this news report that just came out of Ecuador. The title? Former president arrested for illegal profiting from COVID-19 supply sales. Starts by saying pre-dawn raids in Guayaquil and Quito Wednesday morning resulted in 17 arrests and a confiscation of millions of dollars worth of COVID-19 test kits, antiviral medications, and personal protection gear. Among those taken into custody were former president Abdallah Bucaram, who, according to federal prosecutors, was the head of a network that sold medical supplies and equipment to the social security system of Ecuador, the hospitals and other healthcare facilities, at extremely inflated prices. He's been charged with organized crime participation, embezzlement, and price gouging. Also detained, it says, were former and current employees of the Ecuadorian Social Hospital Network, i.e. friends and cronies of the scumbag ex-president, who authorized the purchases. Wait a minute. Does it really say scumbag? Maybe not, but it should have. All right, then it says, in addition to seizing boxes of thousands of COVID-19 tests and face masks at the former president's home, police also found unregistered firearms for which he's also being charged. More items were found at the home of his son, Delo Bucaram, a former National Assemblyman, a congressman, who's also being charged. Surprise, surprise, it runs in the family. Then it says in Guayaquil, Ecuador, prosecutor Yanina Villagomez said at least $12 million in medical supplies were sold by his network to the Ecuadorian National Health System, the IESS hospitals, with products being sold at a 300% markup from normal prices. Then it says, now get this, according to prosecutors, at least three more national healthcare hospital administrators remain at large as fugitives who left the country on humanitarian flights to my jammy. What's it with these dirtbag Latino politicians who always seem to end up stealing their country blind, buying luxury homes and condos in my jammy, and living happily forever after? So many are convicted criminals who've become fugitives from their own country. The only time they ever seem to get caught and put away is when they make a trek back down to their hometown. Since in Miami, there's just nobodies with money. While back at home, the locals are always sucking up to them and kissing their asses. And, you know, sociopaths can't get enough of that. Doesn't matter if they've been convicted of stealing the country blind. After a few years, after things have died down, they always seem to work their way back to the homeland. And though it's true, everyone here in Latin America, though they hate their politicians, when they see them in person at the grocery store, they suck right up to them. And, you know, for political fugitives with big bankrolls, my jammy is the number one playground for those guys. I don't know why people in the States tolerate that. I just don't get it, though it is another nail in the coffin for Uncle Sam's big brother land. So anyway, this guy fits the pattern perfectly. He stole the country blind, got indicted and convicted, escaped with help from his friends, was in luxury exile in Panama for 10 plus years, and now he's back in his homeland pulling the same crap. Though this time, they got him. Stuff like that seems almost normal down here. Though the thing that makes this guy's case a little more outrageous is that way back in 1997, he was kicked out of office for being mentally unfit, as judged by a Congress that certainly was mentally unfit, too. I mean, that's a prerequisite, right? And what kills me is that in all of these cases, there's always a Miami connection. As if Miami was some kind of permanent safe house for these idiots. And why U.S. and Florida governments permit that, I'll never know. But it is another symptom and clue as to how screwed up the U.S. really is. What a failed state it's become, and it's on its way to third world status, too. And it's not just the maniacal scumbag politicians, either. You don't even have to dig deep to find out that nearly every Latin American drug kingpin, and a ton of mid-level narcos, too, have mansions and beach houses in Miami. And here's another thing I don't get. You know, if you're a felon in the United States, you're just not allowed to leave the country, unless you have permission from the State Department. That's the standing rule anyway. You have to have an interview and give reasons why you're going to leave, and they still can turn you down. I remember reading about that when Mike Tyson's managers would set up boxing matches overseas. He had to get permission because he was a felon. Worse yet, he was a sex offender, so every time he went to another state in the union, he was forced by law when he arrived at the airport to register as a sex offender. And he had to do that in every city he lived, boxed, or hung out in. Now, if that's so, and it's true, you can look it up. Why is it that the U.S. government will fling the doors wide open for convicted felons of other countries? Is there something wrong with that picture, or is it just me? Well, you know, you guys and gals up there who haven't made a single move on your plan B, I feel sorry for you. It's funny, you know, some people are content to live in hell. They don't mind it. They're happy there. Speaking of living in hell up in the States, I was at a house party a couple of days ago. No, not up in the States, here in Latin America. On the Caribbean side. Anyway, it was held at a big, wide-open, airy house on a private beach. No one, by the way, was wearing masks. And the guest breakdown, it was like this. There were four or five Venezuelans, two Colombians, a kind of uppity guy from Argentina who thought he was a little bit higher class than the rest of the Latinos there. Tell you the truth, he tried to bond with me and I couldn't get rid of the guy. Oh, and there was a couple from the DR and a couple from Panama. And since all were Latinos, every conversation was in Spanish. And, you know, as we were sitting around by the pool, the subject of police brutality and the riots and looting in the U.S. came up. And, of course, they directed their questions to me, the sole gringo in the place. Like, I'm supposed to be the answer man. Even though I haven't lived there for 30 years, I was the only gringo around. But, you know, I do connect with friends and family in Chicago and points north every week. And I keep up with the news and scuttlebutt. So, I guess, for them anyway, asking me about the craziness up in the States is better than nothing. The thing is, every single one of those Latinos, I think there were 14 of them there, wondered what the hell is happening up in the States. Oh, and by the way, these were middle-class and upper-middle-class Latinos who'd never visited the States. Though they all wanted to in a big way, most of them just couldn't get visas, even tourist visas, to visit. A few of them had tried. They wanted to go where else? Miami and Disney World, but they were rejected. Because even to visit the States legally as a tourist, any Latino has to jump through a million hoops, go down to the embassy, fill out tons of paperwork, get bank statements, credit card statements, a police good conduct report, letters of referral, etc. And actually sit for an interview at the U.S. Embassy. Then pay $300 that's non-refundable. And believe me, 9 out of 10 Latinos get rejected. So imagine all the money the U.S. Embassy collects. Which is why, you have to imagine, so many sneak through Mexico. But not these Latinos. They weren't poor Mexicans or Central Americans. They all had good jobs and nice cars and decent homes. With their number one wish being to go to Miami and Disney World. Ugh. You know, it's so hard to keep my mouth shut when I hear people say that. I really want to set them straight, but I don't want to rain on their parade. Hell, it's a party. So anyway, none of the Latinos or Latinas at this house party had ever been to the States, and they're wondering, what's going on with all the riots and unrest? They understand that a black guy got killed while he's being arrested, and it was captured on video. That video has been seen around the world. Latinos know all about that. But the question they're asking is, why all the looting and rioting? What's that got to do with police brutality, and how is that going to fix it? They all said there's police brutality in every Latin country, but there's a big difference. The common Latino response is never to loot and destroy businesses you buy your products from. And you never wreck houses in your own neighborhood or anyone else's neighborhood. What they do is they get together, storm a police station, burn it down, and then flip over a couple of patrol cars, and maybe set a few of those on fire. You don't go wrecking people's property, people's houses, and innocent businessmen in the neighborhood that you're friends with normally, and that you buy your liquor and your groceries from. So there I was, sitting around with Latinos from five different Latin countries. You know what they said? They think the people of the United States have gone off their rockers, especially the black people. Because you see, they're watching TV too. They're seeing all the protests and the riots, glass breaking, looting. And it has not escaped their notice that although in the peaceful protests against police brutality, where people are carrying signs and just chanting, they're seeing a wide variety of nationalities, blacks, whites, Latinos, Asians. But when it comes to the actual looting and pillaging, it's almost always black people who are doing the dirty. Oh, and by the way, there were three black Latinos at this party. The Dominican couple and a guy from Panama. And, you know, as usual, when you run into black people here in Latin America, they don't refer to themselves as black. And they correct you on it, too. No matter how dark they are, and some of them are extremely dark, especially the ones from Haiti, they always refer to themselves as morenos or Latinos oscuros, dark-skinned Latinos. Oh, and some dark-skinned Latinos on the Caribbean side, Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico, Honduras, Panama, and down south in Brazil, refer to themselves as Indios or Indias, which of course in Spanish means Indian, like American Indian. And it even says that on their passports and national IDs. And to further complicate things, in countries that have lots of indigenous people, like Guatemala, Mexico, and El Salvador, if you use the word Indio or India, it's an insult. Kind of like saying you're white trash or using the N-word. So, for example, in Mexico, Guatemala, El Salvador, etc. Oh, and by the way, oddly enough, we're talking mostly about Latin countries that have a Pacific coast. I said Pacific coast as opposed to the Atlantic or Caribbean coast. You'll never see that word India or India printed on one of their national IDs or cedulas. Though you'll hear the nicer, more proper term indigenous thrown around a lot, you'll never hear the word Indio unless it's an insult. However, as you move to the Caribbean coastal countries of Latin America, when you use the term Indio or India, there's no such negative connotation. Don't ask me why, that's just the way it is. Turns out the more indigenous people in a Latin country, the more they hate that word Indio. Which does make sense because, for example, if you go to a place like the Dominican Republic, the DR, where they have virtually no indigenous people, you'll see those words Indio or India on a good percentage of people's cedulas and national IDs. In fact, one time I went down to the driver's testing station with a Dominican girl, and she pulled out her ID. I had a look at it, and it said, for skin color, India. And I told her they could never get away with that in a place like Guatemala or El Salvador. She gave me a quizzical look and said, what? But back to the police brutality, rioting, and looting thing. Like I said, Latinos are baffled, because their response would have been to burn a few police stations, flip a few patrol cars, and torch them, too. They'd destroy government property, all right. They've got no love at all for government or politicians, which in a way goes right to the hypocrisy of Latinos too, because every one of them would love to get a sack job in government. You know what a sack job is, right? It means you just come in every day, sit there like a dead sack of potatoes, and collect your dough on payday. Yeah, it's schizophrenic, all right? Everyone hates the government, but they would love a government job. Makes sense, though, since in some cases, government jobs pay 2 to 3 times what the same job pays in the private sector. Plus, they've all got unions, so it's almost impossible to get fired. Unless, I've been told this anyway, you get too greedy and steal more than the next guy. Or perhaps you killed the boss. Though that might not even qualify unless maybe you screwed his wife, too. At least that's what one of my favorite Latino lawyers tells me. And you know, looking at that disaster that's unfolding up in the States right now, starting with COVID-19, the popping of the everything bubble, the massive $25 trillion debt, depression-style unemployment, widespread police brutality, looting, rioting, Big Brother, Big Pharma, and the surveillance state. Man, if that's not enough to push you over the edge, get you thinking about getting the hell out of Dodge in a hurry, then it really is true. Some people don't mind hell. They're all right with it. Though admittedly, having a plan B is not for everyone. You have to have a brain and an above-average IQ, or it just won't make sense to you. Oh, and speaking of IQs, above average and otherwise, I just got done reading this article that scared the hell out of me. Or I should say would have scared the hell out of me if I still lived up in Chicago, or anywhere up in the States for that matter. Oh, and if you want a copy or a link to any of the articles I read snippets from, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. Anyway, this one's entitled, Can a Person Actually Be Too Smart to Be a Cop in America? Now, there's a catchy title for you. It starts out, considering all the police brutality and officer-involved shootings in the U.S. news these days, here's a rhetorical question for you. How well do police hiring practices select for candidates who can actually understand and interpret the Constitution or use proper discretion while protecting and serving America? Well, it says, a federal court's decision back in 2000 suggests that the average cop is not necessarily all that smart. For example, it says Robert Jordan, a 49-year-old college graduate, scored 33 on an intelligence test he took as part of his application to become a police officer in the town of New London, Connecticut. A 33 on that test meant Jordan had an IQ of 125, well above average. Now, for the uninitiated, people with a score of 90 to 110 are of average intelligence. About 51.16% of the U.S. population test in that range. Whereas if you have an IQ of 111 to 120, that's called above average, with 15.7% of the U.S. population testing in that range. And people with an IQ of 121 to 130 are considered gifted, 6.4% of the population tests in that range. And over 130, considered very gifted, only 2.1% of the population is in that range. By the way, when people say IQ tests aren't fair because they're culturally biased, that's been adjusted for. Culturally fair IQ tests are being used and they're certified. Obviously, you couldn't expect someone who lives in Ethiopia to know about hockey or anything at all about the Ukraine. In fact, IQ tests are the most predictable and well-known of all sociologic measures. So these days, if you take an IQ test, you can take a culturally fair intelligence test or a classical IQ test. And with both of them, the numbers they come up with are often very close. So anyway, a 49-year-old college grad, Robert Jordan, scored an IQ of 125 on the New London, Connecticut police exam, where the average score for police officers taking that test was 21 to 22, or an average IQ of 104. Jordan later found out the New London police force would only interview candidates who scored between 20 and 27, an IQ of about 100 to 110. So Jordan sued the city, alleging discrimination. But the Second U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals in New York upheld that it wasn't discrimination. Why? Because the New London Police Department applied the same standard to all candidates, not just him. So basically, they only wanted dead average cops. And the theory behind it? They said that those who scored too high could get bored with police work and leave soon after costly training. That, according to ABC News, who was reporting the story. So, while acknowledging the basic fact that such a policy might be unwise, the Supreme Court determined it had a rational basis because it was put in place to lower cop turnover. In other words, hire a bunch of average cops, none of them smart, gifted, or brilliant, to work a job mentally stimulating enough for an average guy, but no more. Sorry, no smart guys allowed, not in this club. After that ruling, nothing changed. The police department went on to continue automatically disqualifying anyone whose IQ was too high. Then the article finishes off with this. It says, America's local law enforcement agencies, of which there are 18,000 plus, more than any other country in the world, are not encouraging geniuses to apply to be officers. In fact, geniuses don't stand a chance, even if they wanted to. Though I guess, and it's me, Johnny, here making a comment, if you're a genius, or even gifted or brilliant, why in the world would you ever want to become a cop anyway? Hey, personally, I've got nothing against cops. I know a lot of very nice, strict, and well-controlled cops when I lived back in Chicago. I got to meet a lot of them. Not that I ever got in trouble. It's just that I played in a pretty popular rock and roll band in the area. And every gig we played, there was security. At that time, anyway, a lot of cops moonlighted as security guards for various functions and events. So I got to see a lot of the same faces over and over again. Good guys, too. Though none of them struck me as geniuses. I'm sure they never looked at me as anything special either. But that was then. We're talking about now. Like I said, I haven't lived in the States for 30 years. You listeners out there would be much better judges. Though I do believe you'd have to be nuts to want to be a cop these days anywhere. Though I could see why for a lot of dead average military types, you know, grunts mustered out for whatever reason, getting a job as a cop is a natural progression. Though I've also read that the average IQ of military guys has gone down over the years, too. It's obvious they're accepting more and more morons and idiots. Might that have anything to do with the miserable public school system, with all the prescription drugs kids are on these days, not to mention all that snowflake crap, social promotions, and participation trophies? Yeah, right, that stuff really builds character, doesn't it? Man, you don't know how glad I am to be here in Latin America. Hey, I'm not saying the cops down here are any better. I ran into some real mental midgets. But I mean that in the kindest Christian sort of way, you know? You longtime listeners have heard me say, once you get south of the border, that is south of the Mexican border, cops are friendly, more than happy to talk to a gringo. Oh, and most of them have never even fired a gun. And they only have one or two bullets on them because they have to buy their own ammo. Shades of Barney Fife, huh? Now, that's not to discount the fact that they won't try to squeeze you sometimes. If you're truly a clueless gringo and walking around like Mr. Moneybags, you could be a target, but most often for very small change. In fact, last time I got nailed, and you probably heard me tell that story, when I was walking around at 9 or 10 o'clock at night, very close to my hotel, and I didn't have an ID on me or a copy. I was just taking a walk. Two cops on a motorcycle pulled up and told me I was required to have ID, and I didn't, so I had to pay a fine. Of course, it was BS. They were just trying to gouge me. But I figured 20 bucks wasn't going to crimp my lifestyle. Plus, I'd made two best friends for life. Plus, it did make for an interesting boots-on-the-ground story, didn't it? But still, in all the 30 years I've been here in Latin America, I think I was only extorted by cops three, maybe four times. And they never got more than 20 bucks out of me. Though I have bought some of the local cops a gallon or two of gas. And I'm always good for a bag of Cheetos and a two-liter jug of Coke. It's the easiest way in the world to make friends with cops, believe me. But you knew that already, right? Oh, and here's another little trick Expat Eddie taught me. You know, Expat Eddie hasn't always had his papers in order. He probably still doesn't. He knows if he gets pulled over, he could be in some trouble. So just for example, if he's driving with an expired driver's license, even an average idiot Latin American cop might pick up on the fact that it's expired. Even if the cop knows zero English, he can still read the numbers. So here's Eddie's trick. If he spots a roadblock up ahead and he thinks he's going to get stopped. Now remember, if there's a roadblock, they're probably going to pull over one out of every 20 or 30 or even 50 cars. So there's a very slim chance you're going to get pulled over. However, sometimes you'll see a roadblock with a couple of cops standing around and there's no traffic. You're practically the only one on the road, which increases your odds of being selected substantially. And as for Eddie, I've been with him when he's done this. If the traffic is sparse and he sees a roadblock like that, he'll put on his emergency flashers well before he ever gets to the roadblock. He'll slow way down and pull right over, pull a map out of his glove compartment, get out, walk over to the cops, and play the lost, clueless gringo act. He'll speak in English, but throw in a few choice, mispronounced words in Spanish. And guess what? All of a sudden, the cops are gathered around looking at the map. They'll point this way and that way and happily give him directions he never needed. And of course, since he pulled over way before they could flag him down, they never thought to ask him for his papers, because he was a gringo in distress. Hey, I saw him do it twice. By the way, when it comes to driver's licenses and getting pulled over, in almost all Latin countries, they're extremely lenient. Except Costa Rica, where the national pastime is gouging gringos. So anywhere but Costa Rica, if you have a foreign driver's license, US, Canada, whatever, it's as good as gold, no problem. And it seems like it's only been in Costa Rica where lots of the cops know English. And they're seeing large quantities of tourists, where they'll try to enforce a certain rule that says, if you've been in the country more than 6 months, you have to have a Costa Rican driver's license. And you can only get one of those if you're a permanent resident of Costa Rica. Same is true in every Latin country. In order to get a driver's license from that country, you have to be a permanent resident. But I've never seen that enforced in any other Latin country except Costa Rica, where, as mentioned, gouging gringos is the national sport, or one of them anyway. And cops there are very good at it. They've got 1,000 ways to squeeze dough out of you right on the spot. Doesn't matter, for example, if your Canadian license has 3, 4, 5 years to run. If you're in the country driving after more than 6 months, cops will hit you with a $100 to $500 fine on the spot. Of course, a good percentage of the time it ends up in their pockets. Because you never pay a fine on the spot, that's illegal. So in the end, that makes it reason 1,246 why I don't recommend Costa Rica for your plan B. Though it's a great place to go for a weekend or a couple of weeks holiday. I don't recommend you invest or stake roots there. Oh, and another place I would never recommend gringos and expats to live, Argentina. Not only is the country completely bankrupt, and they're running at 50% inflation per year. If that weren't enough, here's the topper. And I'll read this from an article you just might want me to send you for proof. It says, according to Argentine newspaper Perfil, Argentina recently approved a new law, 22.909, that declares vaccinations as a national interest, stating that vaccinations are a social good for all. According to the new law, and I'm translating this from Spanish, vaccination is of a national interest, and we understand that research, epidemiological surveillance, decision-making based on evidence, acquisition, storage, distribution, and provision, etc., is highly important. It says, from now on, vaccines and their application are free and mandatory in Argentina, and totally provided by the government in all stages of life. Being vaccinated, and get this, will be necessary and required for procedures such as entry and exit into the country and entry and exit for children into the school system. Proof of vaccination will be required for processing or renewal of national IDs, passports, residence, medical procedures for work, for marriage certificates, as well as driver's licenses, and processing of legal and family documents. It finishes up by saying it's important to recognize that adults understand they will be required to have certain vaccines such as hepatitis B, diphtheria, and tetanus. That's our new public policy for control and prevention of vaccine-preventable diseases. Whoa, did you get that? Hey, I know a lot of you are listening to the show because you want to get started on that Plan B, but forget about Costa Rica and Argentina, believe me. Oh, and you can add Cuba, Venezuela, and Mexico to that list too. But you know, that still leaves you 15 out of 20 very viable options. And of course, you know, the best way to get your Plan B jump-started and turbocharged is to join me at my Expat Insider Seminar. Sign-ups are underway right now for my August seminar. Starts on the evening of the 21st, a Friday night, and finishes up Thursday night, August 27th. For all the details and sign-up info, including the early bird discounts, they'll be in effect till the end of June. Just go to expatplanb.com and click on the seminar link. Oh, and once again, we're looking for a lady to share double occupancy. That means she'll save $750 off the single rate. So if you're interested in a roommate, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. South of the border. You've been listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America. If you need some help with your own Plan B, we can schedule a one-on-one phone or Skype consult. Just send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. And if you want to get on the waiting list for my next week-long Expat Insider Seminar in Central America, where you're guaranteed to get a 2 to 5 year head start on your Plan B, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. Nos vemos.